1 to 5 million people is the ideal range for a sustainable city. We'll talk about why that is and what to do if you live or want to live somewhere bigger or smaller than that in this episode. Welcome to Edenicity, Best Practices for Sustainably Abundant Cities. This channel exists as an alternative or supplement to traditional environmental activism. I've lived through nearly 6 decades of the environmental movement pleading with people to consume less, and unfortunately, it just hasn't worked. We have more consumption than ever, more extinctions than ever, and climate change is out of control. The question is, why has all the effort that so many millions of people have put in for actually about a century now come to naught? Well, it's exhausting to fight a system on which you depend for your day-to-day survival. The systems that produce the shelter, food, energy, and transportation that you rely on every day for your survival are all constructed in such a way that they harm the environment. If you try to fight that system, it's really hard when you go to the grocery store and you look for organic produce, or you go to the farmer's market and it's wrapped in plastic. Maybe you get on your bike and try to ride there, and in the United States, it feels like you're taking your life into your hands. What Edenicity does is consider the environment from a completely different perspective. We're looking at it from the perspective of design. Can we redesign those life support systems that meet our housing, energy, transportation, and food needs in such a way that we enjoy a higher, not lower, quality of life? We have easier, not more difficult choices, and we end up using 96% less land, energy, and materials. Now, don't freak out about that 96%. I know that seems like an incredible number, but that's the power of design. Think about it this way. When I was a kid, the idea of putting a phone in your pocket was ludicrous. Phones were way too big, and they would just never fit in your pocket. And besides which, they required wires. Today, with a smartphone, you can easily, of course, fit the phone in your pocket, but also massive libraries of information, more than would fit in all the libraries in the world, as well as maps, arcades, satellite navigation. So even though smartphones are a lot smaller than the phones of yesteryear, they do a lot more for us, and this makes us wealthier. And people overwhelmingly now prefer smartphones to landlines. So the point, again, is not about phones. It's about great design, having the ability to create orders of magnitude change, meaning factors of 10 to 100 or more change in our lives, and package them in a way that we really like. This is what Edenicity is all about doing. Now, what's the right scale to operate? The traditional phrase among environmentalists is small is beautiful. But having lived my life in community, on a homestead, I've lived in a boat in a harbor, I've lived in tiny houses, I can tell you from lived experience that none of these have caught on. Whether they were good ideas or not, the fact is that nearly a century of this kind of living or more has not convinced the majority of humanity to go live like that. What about the big scale, nations, the United Nations? I think it's pretty obvious that these are not only too slow to change, but these institutions are too volatile and inconsistent. Well, what about something in between? Not homesteads and not nations? Well, what about cities? These have some really amazing advantages. They have enormous amounts of social energy, which I discussed in the last episode. This is the potential to build social capital, to build relationships that are valuable to you. They're just big enough to where we can design all four of those systems together, the housing, transportation, energy, and yes, food, to work together harmoniously on the same footprint. They have the capacity to change much faster than entire nations, and they are kind of a natural laboratory where people can try different ideas in different places in parallel with far fewer consequences for failure. So the concept of Edenicity is to make an Eden-like city where we build quality, sustainable housing and transportation and meet all of our food and energy needs renewably on site. And to do all that, we take design cues from natural ecology, which has been massively optimized over billions of years for incredible efficiency. Okay, what's the minimum size for Edenicity? For various reasons, when I was putting together the initial design, I came up with about 150,000 people as the minimum unit. And as it happened, a couple of years later, when I attended an international housing delegation to a number of cities that I write about in this book, you can find it on edenicity.com, The mega architects of Singapore told us about their new towns, which were meant to meet most people's daily needs on site to minimize the size of the highways that they would need to build and also the size of the rail infrastructure that they would need to build. So these are truly nearly self-sufficient towns. And guess what? Their size was 90,000 to 200,000 people. So I had my own analysis, but basically I trust the analysis of the builders of an actual city of 5 million people who broke it up into nearly self-sufficient new towns of 90,000 to 200,000 people. So Edenicity Town would be something in the range of 150,000 people. Now, as I show you these drawings, understand that these are abstract. They are schematic, more abstract than a subway map. They're meant to be easy to draw and easy to understand, but putting them into practice on a physical landscape would require many, many thousands of hours of work and the input of lots of people from the community. And it would be subject to geographic boundaries that would change the shape from the perfect rectilinear pattern that you see to something a lot more organic that follows the contours of the landscape. And Edenicity Town is big enough for education all the way through college, a full-service hospital, markets, shops, offices, fine dining. But as a whole, that's a pretty unwieldy number of people. It would be pretty chaotic. And so it is chunked into 25 villages. And again, that number can vary, let's say between 10 and 30 villages, of about 6,000 people. And again, these numbers are very round. Now, a village of about 6,000 people is big enough so that you can have many local jobs, businesses, and services, gardens, farms, restaurants, bakeries, daycare, and elementary school, with about 60-ish children per grade. And of course, all of this is car-free. Are you getting this? In Edenicity, you don't have to drive your kids to school. They can walk and it's perfectly safe. Each village would have enough population to support a very small clinic and a fire department with about a 1 minute response time, as well as, of course, bike repair shops, deliveries, and other small shops. Each village would in turn be chunked down into roughly 25 blocks. Again, it could be 10 blocks, it could be 50 blocks. The point is that it's a manageable number where you don't get overwhelmed by the number of people that you're dealing with every day. The Edenicity town of 25 villages of 25 blocks would have a decent amount of social energy. Many people would be very content to live their entire lives, or most of their lives, within these villages. But some people would find them stiflingly small. The shopping, the medical care, the concerts, the sports would all be pretty small scale and pretty basic. So they would be delighted to know that if the town is thriving, it would probably grow past 150,000. But how? Rather than simply expand the borders of a town of 150,000, the ideal thing to do with Edenicity would be to start a second town, build that out to 150,000, and then a third town. And well before that second town gets going, really we should be thinking in terms of a region. And that gets us into the ideal size range for Edenicity. A region includes somewhere in the range of 5 to maybe 16 towns and holds altogether about 1 to 2 million people. It has really great social energy. It has enough population for big hospitals with a lot of specialization, big sports and concert venues, a major university, maybe an opera house. And remember, the pattern of Edenicity builds in thick farm belts between the villages and thick tree belts between each of the towns so that everyone is always close to woodlands and working farms. Now, we could stop there at the scale of regions and say, okay, 1 million person cities, is this really best for the environment? I would argue no. What's best for the environment and a little bit better for people is somewhat bigger, fewer cities. Here's why. With bigger cities, you have less disruption of wild habitats and they're a little bit cheaper to connect. Here's an example. The United States has a population of 330 million people, which would be the equivalent of 2,200 Edenicity towns, and they would be about 61 kilometers or 38 miles apart. That is a lot of roads to maintain. If you combine them into regions, instead of 2,200 towns, you could now have 244 Edenicity regions. That would be 182 kilometers apart, three times farther apart. Far fewer roads, far less disruption of wild habitats. Now, as the regions grow, as you might expect, when you get to 1 to 2 million people in a region, you should really start thinking, if you're not geographically bounded, about building another region. This is called the constellation city model, and it's what Singapore followed. Singapore is comprised of 5 regions with about 3 to 7 new towns each, for a total of 23 new towns altogether. So in the full preferred version of Edenicity, you'd have about 4 regions, 9 towns each, population 5 million. You can download the reference design and follow along from Edenicity.com. See the link in the description. But in a month, there's going to be an update. Many of the numbers are going to change because we can have more and still achieve the ecological numbers that I was hoping for. So it's really good news. So with this reference design, with the United States population of 330 million people, that would be 66 cities of 5 million people, 350 kilometers or 217 miles apart. Now the population of the United States, along with the rest of the world, is growing. It's forecast to grow and level off somewhere toward the end of the century. So I ran the numbers for having 100 Edenicity-sized cities. This would be a total population in the U.S. of 540 million versus 330 million today, and they would be 284 kilometers or 177 miles apart. This is the exact density that you would have that if you extrapolated it all over the habitable landmass of the world would house a population of up to 10 billion people. So I'm not saying everybody would have to live this way, but it is an option that is absolutely sustainable and would 100% accommodate future population growth that's been forecast. But now here's the question. You're living in Edenicity. It's 5.4 million people and more people want to live there. Well, now what? Well, I would prefer that people find a nearby city and bring it up to Edenicity standards. But if for whatever reason that can't happen, here's how a city can grow. You basically just add more regions. And so unbounded cities like Columbus, Indianapolis, Houston could easily do something like that. And it would still be very good for the environment because first of all, it's very green within the city and it pulls people out of the surrounding landscapes and reduces the harm that's being done. Okay, what's too big? Let's think of the world's biggest city, Tokyo, 37 million people, which amazingly still has a one-way commute time of just 58 minutes on average. How can growing megacities become more sustainable? The Edenicity way, very much in parallel to the Singapore way, would be to make long-term plans to develop regions within the city of, you guessed it, 1 to 2 million people. Here's an Edenicity example with 24 regions, population 32 million. Now again, this is a schematic view, so it's easy to draw and understand. And if it's on land without boundaries, we could easily expand it to 36 regions, population 48 million, with exactly the same access times. The town centers are 3 to 4 minutes apart by metro, so the commute times would be 52 minutes from the most distant town center to the city center, which is comparable to Tokyo, but of course, this is the idealized case. It's not bounded by physical geography and other constraints. So it would be very hard to match Tokyo's performance. An enormous amount of work went into making Tokyo's transit system as efficient as it is. That is not a small piece of work to try to match. Now, I want to disclaim that I'm not a transit designer. This is a field with a great deal of very sophisticated engineering with many, many decades of real-world experience behind it in many cities throughout the world. All I'm trying to do is show what's possible. I believe that a very junior-level transit designer could kind of laugh their way through this and redesign it and do a much better job. But this is just to show that something like this, or probably better, is possible. Imagine you had a relative way on the other side of the city that you wanted to visit. The longest possible route that I could find to visit grandma was 72 minutes. One way. And again, this is not optimized. These routes are super convoluted because I just went with the first thing that sort of worked, just to show that it is theoretically possible to make it work on a scale this big. How can growing megacities become more sustainable? They should start with waterways and daylight buried creeks. Creeks are often buried just to control flooding, but when you daylight them, that starts to invite a lot more of the natural ecology back into the landscape. And as you start to rewild some of the urban landscape, you have those waterways right there in the city to draw from. And you can use these to create and link green spaces such as tree belts and farm belts. And of course, in parallel with daylighting the creeks and establishing the tree and farm belts, cities should move as quickly as they can to redevelop to high density with car-free development and metro rail, and I'll get into some of the details of that in a couple of episodes. But basically, the way this would look like on the ground is parking lots and streets, and a lot of the car infrastructure that takes up to 80% of the area of a city would turn into farms, forests, and housing. So the big cities, I think, could go up to maybe as much as 50 million people, especially if they're not geographically bounded, sitting right on a coast. What about towns and cities smaller than an Edenicity town of about 150,000 people? So the bad or good news, depending on your point of view, is that if you're living in such a place, there really is no end-to-end Edenicity strategy for it. Edenicity really is about big cities. When I think of small places, I think of, for example, Athens, Ohio, where I lived for 8 years. Population 23,000 plus 21,000 students of Ohio University. This is a town that used to make money in timber, coal, brickmaking, and small manufacturing. It's geographically bounded by hills on all sides. It will never get big. There's a lot of refugees from economic downturns who have settled in the area because the land is really cheap and super beautiful. And from generation to generation, people learn to get by. Everybody hunts, everybody gathers, everybody gardens. When I was a foster parent, I was astonished that some of the children as young as 3 knew how to find edible wild foods in the environment and happily munched away on wild leeks and wild lamb's quarters. Now it's mainly a university town with some specialized manufacturing, biotech, electronics, home solar power, and musical instruments. It's got a farmer's market and an amazing food culture. I was a market gardener there for 3 years. And it has 20 miles of protected bike paths, which is more per capita than places like Houston by like an order of magnitude, although Houston is quickly catching up. My experience of Athens was it's a place with very low social energy, low potential for building social capital, but people had done an incredible job building what social capital they could. So much higher social capital than you would expect for an area that small. For people who want to live more sustainably in a town like Athens, Ohio, and there's many such places in the United States, the key is to find ways to share more with your neighbors. So in Athens, for example, there's a tool library, and this was one of my favorite places. Get closer to the land, work on restoring biodiversity, learn, value, and apply indigenous land management practices, especially those that increase biodiversity, and consider tapping into the social energy of big cities. I know of people who run summer eco camps for big city kids and have done fairly well with that. That just scratches the surface. These places have a lot of ingenuity, a lot of creativity. The opportunity is just get closer to the land and learn more about the land. So what does this mean for Edenicity? Where will Edenicity actually begin? Basically, we need to start in growing cities with dense urban cores of at least 150,000 people. Plan the regions first, then start building the towns with those tree belts, those farm belts, the high density housing, and the transit region by region. Now, if you want to know more about how Edenicity would be constructed, check out this episode here. Now, in the next 3 episodes, I'm going to take a really deep dive into the transportation system behind Edenicity, because for many cities, that's going to be the key to unlocking all of the rest of the changes and turning a regular city into an Edenicity. You won't want to miss that, so be sure you're subscribed. And while you're at it, leave a like. It helps the channel grow, which it really is doing. I am so delighted with that. And I want to thank the new people who have arrived over the past week or so. It's been a pleasure to welcome you to this exciting concept. Okay, take care, stay green, see you next time.